We are back, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit more as we work through this about the actual techniques that I'm doing. A lot of what I'm doing, we talked in the last little segment about the fur, and in coming in here very quickly and adding fur, I am re-adding that texture that I missed when I darkened this out by compressing the wood. Wood burning is about not just knowing the doing the artwork and making it look like what it's supposed to look like. It's about learning the little techniques. The more techniques that you can learn and get under your belt, the better. If you are in an area that has woodburning or pyrography workshops, and you can sometimes find them even under various different types of trade shows or craft fairs that you might not think of when you initially are thinking about woodburning. In other words, if you are looking for a trade show or someplace that will give you tutorials or tips or lessons or hands-on about woodburning, one of the areas that you may want to check into is knife and gun shows. And the reason that you might want to check into that is because some of the knife makers do scrimshaw, where they're actually doing either pyrography or doing etching and then annealing into knife blades, knife handles rather, and they carve out or they wood burn into bone or horn or wood these very intricate patterns. And so sometimes they do classes for the members and for people who are getting into that scrimshaw is what it's called. And another thing that you can see is sometimes you'll find it at wood conventions where people are working with carving and things like that. You can oftentimes find people that will give you tutorial assistance as you're doing that. And so you can go to these places and you can take up a course in woodburning or pyrography 101, and basically it's just a nice way to brush up on your techniques. You can also get instructional videos and books. There are plenty of people out there that have them. I believe Sue Walters had some, Nedra Dennison, and a lot of other different pyrographers that put out their books. I couldn't even begin to tell you all of the different books and videos and DVDs that are out there. There's a lot of them. Basically, the most important thing that I would say about that is if you're a beginning pyrographer, it really doesn't matter where you're getting your techniques from, because everybody's got good stuff to contribute. If you have a little more experience under your belt, if you're somebody who's been doing this for a while and you've got a good feel for the basic hobby, you're going to want something more advanced, something more your level, if you will. You may want to start looking for videos that are done by people or instructional books that are written by authors who may be a little bit more advanced than some of the people offering the basic stuff. And that's not knocking any of the people that I mentioned. Nedra Dennison is one of the people. She has a fair amount of skill in pyrography. She's not a bad burner. Sue Walters, of course, is a very good burner. I don't know if Julie Benders or any of these other people have books or videos out. But basically, if they do, those are great to study and to learn from. Look at pyrographers who are on the same wavelength or maybe the same subject matter or are on a skill level that you either wish to be at or are similar to, and then go from there. If you're trying to learn new tricks or new techniques, they're going to be the ones that maybe have something that you haven't seen before or have a way to really enhance your pyrography. It's not that you can't learn from anybody, but you might as well learn from who you feel is going to best benefit you. And so take the time to do your research on your different artists. Everybody's got different skill levels and different things that they bring to the table. And that's very important. What I'm doing right now is just basically laying back a fur foundation to make up for fur that I have smoothed out when I came back over to add in some detail. Now, the thing that you have to be aware of is that when you compress that fur down, you do create little lighter filaments inside there as well. So some of what you just darkened will seem like it lightens out. So you want to make sure you've got enough filaments there and compressed to keep the darkness that you just created with the side edge. Remember, we use the knife edge of your tool. So you want to make sure that you have enough there to keep that nice and even. And so the combination of turning up the heat, like I said, right now I'm working at about 800, maybe 850. But with the heat turned up and enough repetition, you're going to get in all those furs. In the time that I've been talking to you between the two videos, I've already added about 500 hairs. Time kind of flies as you're going along. And you can count these out too. We talked a little bit about counting out hairs and some of the things because it adds value to the appraisal of the art. Another thing, I recently addressed this in an online thing on Facebook, but I'm going to mention it to people because who weren't privy to the discussion or hadn't seen it or been aware. I'm on a big crusade right now, and my crusade is against the people that are doing abstract art. And it's not because I dislike the people personally. I really don't. It's not even because I dislike abstract art, although I don't. It's that I don't respect the art form very much because it's so simplistic. And because I've actually seen abstract artists and other pseudo-artists that basically have argued that this is an actual pure art form and have had the temerity to tell me that art forms like scratchboard and pyrography and various different paintings, all these realist art forms, that basically these people are just human copying machines. I hear this all the time. It's one of the most popular arguments that's lobbied by people who have no talent at all or have very little talent in art and have taken some art and maybe got themselves even an art degree, and they think that that degree entitles them to put down other artists or to state that their own opinion on art is more prevalent and more relevant. That's a bunch of baloney. These people don't know crap about art, and basically a lot of people who don't have talent will still hide behind that by creating abstract art, impressionist art, surrealist art, although I have to give some of the surrealists credit. There are some very talented surrealists who do realistic warpings of art, and they have the talent, so I can't criticize them as being no talented or not taking some time in doing surrealism. While I don't like surrealism personally, I at least can say that there's a lot of talented artists in the surrealist movement, and I'm not going to knock them. But impressionists and modernists and these postmodernist artists who are doing weird stuff and cubism and all the rest of this, I'm sorry, but it's a joke. And it's always going to be a joke in my mind, and it has no value. And unfortunately, in the art world, value is perceived by the way that the dealers and the people in the mainstream have set their pricing. And in order to counteract that, we who are doing finer detailed arts, the fine arts, where you've got realism and photorealism and what's called hyperrealism, these artists, it's up to the artists in these movements to basically shut down this perception, to counter it, and to bring it back to reality. So I would urge you, if you're a realist or a photorealist, to start taking your art very literally seriously and to really start pushing it. Don't sell your stuff short. Don't sell it as a craft. Sell it as an art form, because it's what it is. Be proud of it as an art form. It has a very ancient history. It has a lot of strength behind it. And we need to knock down this wall or the stigma that it's a craft, that it's kids' craft that's done at camps and Boy Scouts, and start getting people into the mindset that this is a legitimate art form that's been around for a long time, longer than most other art forms, in fact. And with that sort of stigma should also come the ability to sell this art form for what it's actually worth instead of what people get nowadays. And, hopefully what you're doing will come out, and I'm not trying to sell you on do this for profit only, but hopefully what you're selling will be more heavily valued, and overall appreciation of the art will go up, and as appreciation grows and people's interests grow, we'll get more artists involved, we'll get more people involved, and pyrography will get a nice firm foothold like it deserves in the art world. Thank you for watching these videos. Have a wonderful day, and happy holiday seasons to you guys. And, you know, like I said, if you have any questions, get a hold of me on Facebook, or get a hold of me on, you know, any of the other public media that I'm on, or on my websites. Come visit me, and feel free to ask. You know, I'm always there, and I'm always hoping to be able to answer any questions you have. And if I can't find you an answer, hopefully I can find you somebody who can. So that said, take care, and happy woodburning.